Right, hello everyone and welcome. We have on the show today a guy that I've been keeping an eye on for a while. His content is absolutely brilliant. His plan is to go from the minimum wage to financially independent in 3 years and to own a yacht outright along the way. I would like to introduce to you my very special guest, Mr. Perry Wilson from Stupid is the Norm. Perry, how are you?
I'm fantastic, Shane. Thank you very much for inviting me on your show.
Yeah, no problem. I've been, as soon as I seen your content on YouTube, and actually saw you through the famous Might Win It, actually, I just had to get hold of you, and I just thought you were brilliant, and that, you know, how your motto, you don't have to be like financially...
You don't need to be financially sophisticated at all to become wealthy. That's absolutely right. First of all, you kindly said, mentioned you'd seen me on the Might Win It show. I need a big shout out to Mike, who's been a marvelous help to me. I spent two and a half years, like a voice in the wilderness, making videos, which very few people were watching, and then almost an overnight success when I appeared on the Mike Win It podcast. But yeah, my message is, and the reason that I started my own YouTube channel was to prove to people that anybody can become wealthy. And I genuinely believe that, with one caveat. I think you have to be able to work, and there are very unfortunate, tragic people who, through disability, mental or physically, will find it very difficult to do that. Although, that said, there are lots of more possibilities on the internet for making money from home, from a sedentary position, than there used to be. But those unfortunate people aside, I truly believe that anyone can become wealthy, providing they're able to work for it. And I think that's probably the difference between the wealthy and the non-wealthy. They take action and they behave in very different ways to the way I used to believe. I used to work. I was 59 when I started, 57 when I started my journey, working behind a bar, minimum wage, £10,000, the credit card debt, no money in the bank, essentially just normal bloke, because that's how most people are, live their life hand to mouth. And I just changed the way I behaved in a very short time, and it changed my life massively. And so I'm 2.5 years into the project. I've bought my first property. I'm in the process of buying my second property. And when I buy my third property in July next year, I will then become financially independent. So I've gone from pretty much insolvent to being financially independent, where the income from my investments will cover the cost of my living expenses, if you wish. And I've done it in 3 years. And get back to what I started to say was that the reason I documented this, because A, I wanted to prove that it could be done, and B, I wanted to leave some sort of route so that if anyone else wanted to do it, then they could just copy what I did. You didn't have to pay lots of money to a financial guru, you know, thousands of pounds selling courses. You see them on the internet. You just watch my videos and do what I did, and you too will replicate what I did.
Yeah, and I think that's brilliant. That's amazing, and that's what kind of drew me to I wanted to get you on the show. I want people to see you from far away to show that it's possible. Like, you don't need to be like smart to be a millionaire or anything. Like, you just have to have just basic knowledge. Pick up a book, learn from people like yourself. As you said, don't need to pay thousands of pounds for all these get rich quick courses, because they're a load of bollocks. And, you know, as long as
you're right, you're absolutely right. If a prerequisite to becoming wealthy was you had to be clever or intelligent, then those cleverest amongst us would be the wealthiest. So, you know, you go to a university where the marvelous seats of learning we have in this country, where the most intelligent people in the world, not just the students, but the professors, and you'd expect to see the car parks full of supercars because they're making loads of money. But that's not the case. So, you don't have to be clever. You just have to do some pretty simple things in order to become wealthy. And I think sometimes people look at the wealthy and think, you know, how I can't. It's almost self-defeating. I can never achieve what they achieve. So what's the point in trying? And again, that's the reason I started my YouTube, was just saying, you just got to do something very different. Well, I did. I was an absolute nut job. And can I say the reason that I've taken such a Spartan attitude to the whole thing? That is to say, I work extremely hard in terms of hours. I do a very normal job, you know. I'm not a consultant, I think I'm just a bloody cab driver. But I do work around about between 60 and 75 hours a week. So effectively two full-time jobs. And the reason that I have to do this, because I was stupid for most of my life, and that I did the normal things that everybody does. You know, your holiday, you get your 2 weeks holiday a year, you take work Monday to Friday, get Saturdays and Sundays off. You get yourself a bigger car than you can afford, you buy yourself a bigger house than you need, you buy branded clothes, and if you can't afford them, you buy them on credit cards, and that's how I ended up in so much debt at the time. But that's just been normal. Everybody does that. But that's what keeps you from being wealthy, because the wealthy don't do that. The wealthy do something very special. They don't behave like we do. And when I realized that all I had to do was change my behavior, then my life changed. But there are some sacrifices, of course, and most people aren't willing to pay those sacrifices.
I think, the sacrifices that needed to be made, for people that want to get rich early on, they need to sacrifice a portion of their time, let's say 10, 15 years or a little bit longer, to have then when they do go to retire at 50, as opposed to retiring at 60, and then they could be wealthy then. Whereas they're just, it's that whole instant gratification, isn't it? And they want to have it now. And we're a part of that. We want it now society. It has to be.
And also, as human beings, we're herd animals. Very few of us like to be hermits and separate ourselves from the herd. Most of us like to be liked, and most of us will therefore fit in and do what our peers do, because, well, if you're different from the herd, you get ostracized and they'll point at you and say, look at him, he thinks he's better than we are and he's not being like us. And that's part of the sacrifice, that you have to be different from the herd. If you want to achieve something remarkable, then you've got to do something remarkable, and you can't be like every other people, because if you're like everybody else, then you'll get what everybody else has gotten. And that's the reality of it. So it is very much a trade-off, as you say. Don't consume when you're young, and invest as much as you can when you're young, so that when you're older, you can consume massively then, if that's what you choose to do, by the way, if consumption is your wish. If I'd have done, one of the biggest regret I had, because and now I know how to do it and now it's working and I'm recording how I'm doing it. If I'd have done it when I was 20, I would have retired at 30, or did it when I was 30, or retired at 40. But I'd spent so much of my life just waiting for the universe to recognize my genius and say, here you are, Perry, there's your money. You've deserved it. You've got this far. And by God, there's your job, without working for it. And the reality is that's not how it works. And you've got to sacrifice something. So you're sacrificing your consumption now for consumption later, or you invest time now so you've got more free time later. But there's a cost. There is a cost of it. And if somebody says, like these gurus do, for 5 minutes a day on your computer, selling bits on eBay or trading whatever, run a mile. It doesn't work. It doesn't work. It's never been proven to work. Talk to anybody who's wealthy. You're watching what's his name? Peter Jones on Dragon's Den.
Yes.
And he says, with all the companies, and he's an extremely wealthy man, he says, I have to get 2 weeks away by myself in a shed somewhere. It's a nice shed, by the way. It's probably in the Maldives or somewhere. But because my life is so stressful that, I wouldn't be able to live. But people imagine Peter Jones's life as, somebody's driving around in big cars and he doesn't do an awful lot and the money's just attracted to him. No, he's working even at his age now. He's constantly, Elon Musk sleeps on his floor in the office, and he's one of the richest men in the world. Doesn't go home. Doesn't have time to go home. There's a price to be paid.
Absolutely. And you know what? There was another rich guy. I can't remember his name, but he was a Japanese businessman and one of the wealthiest men in Japan. And I read that, because of he's not extravagant, he gets the train to work like everyone else. And he goes into the office with everyone, catches the elevator with everyone to his office floor. And he's the CEO of this big corporation. Can't remember the name of the guy now, but again, just to show the wealthiest, they don't live like how people think wealthy people live, not extravagant.
Well, no, because when we have no money, we like to look wealthy. We like to look successful. Mm. So we'll buy ourselves the trappings of wealth. We'll get a nice German car and we'll get some branded clothes and we'll strut around. And to all intents and purposes, to our friends, we look wealthy. But the reality is we're not. But when you have wealth, there's no need to display it because you have nobody to impress. That's why the guy travels the world. Doesn't need to get a good big car to drive him in there, so people look at him and say, "Oh, look at him!" Past that, once you've got the financial independence and once you've got the money, it's no longer about showing off. It's about enjoying it and relaxing. And that's what the financial independence brings to you. It's the no worries. Your problems, I'd say. We all go through life with problems. But, you know, you don't have any financial problems, as he doesn't. And so he just has no reason to be ostentatious and say, and peacock it around and say, look at me, I'm this guy. There's a need to. He doesn't have that ego anymore. He doesn't need it.
Absolutely. And the ego definitely plays a big part of it, doesn't it? A lot of people that I've certainly seen around myself before will get paid and they'll have nothing to show for it but like the clothes they're wearing on their body, and no one actually cares. Like, oh, was that a Ralph Lauren polo? Well, that's nice, and that'll be it. That's it. And they've paid what, 80 quid for a t-shirt just to have that instant gratification. Like, I don't think it's so pointless.
There was one time, again, I've been stupid in the past. I'd started a business, and I thought, well, you know, if I'm a businessman, I should look like I'm successful. So I remember I forget the actual numbers now, but I bought a 3 Series BMW, which I traded in about 2 months later because I could only get one set of golf clubs in the back, so I needed something bigger, you know. So I got a 5 Series BMW. And I think the finances worked something like this. I think it was about 300 quid a month for the finance. I think the freaking insurance was about 200 quid a month. The fuel was about 100 quid a week in it. But and I reckon that if I'd have taken the money I'd have spent on that car and invested it, I think I did the sums, I would have had £360,000 when I retired. And I just think, tell myself that if it had been in the car showroom, and instead of having £15,000, which is what it said on the windscreen, it had £360,000, I'd have run a mile. There's no way is that car worth £360,000. But that's effectively what it lost me if I continued buying, spending my money and wasting my money in those ways by, you know, buying stupid things that I couldn't afford just to impress people I didn't even like. So, you know, don't do that anymore.
So I'll just touch on, so as you said, you're coming up to your 3-year mark now. So, and then I've been watching your content, and it's you've been saying that you've been looking into franchises. Do you want to talk a little bit about that and how that's going to go? You don't have to disclose what franchise, but
I won't do it just yet, but I will do a video when I do, because one of the things I want to do is to, when I take the franchise on, is to record my progress in that too, so that anybody else can copy that. And if it works, it works. And if it doesn't, well, I'm going to look an arse. But I've spent most of my life looking at arse, so, you know, a few more months will make a difference. But I did it for two reasons. There are three asset classes that will deliver you an income and grow in value, and they are stocks and shares, providing their dividend, stocks and shares, property, and business, a successful business. They will grow in value, and you can still get a wage out of it. So I'm investing in shares. I'm investing mainly in property, and I thought that I could run a business alongside the cabbie business. So it's not to replace the cabbie business. The cabbie business, I save £900 a month and look to invest £900 a month from the cabbie business. So I'm not going to walk away from £900 a month. So I've got to run that. Now the franchise is in the hospitality business, so it's principally weekend work. It's probably going to be seasonal as well, so it's probably going to run from March to September, maybe it's a little more, and bleed into the earlier and later months. But it's something I can do at a weekend that I can run alongside it. And I'm doing that with a friend of mine, my best friend, and I are going to do that. And what I have learned is lots of this, becoming wealthy is about partnerships as well, to getting in skills that you don't know, that I don't have. So my YouTube channel, I've got a business partner there, Will, who's very techie, designs websites. So I shoot the videos and do the content. He glues it all together and puts it on YouTube and all that stuff. I'm buying my second property I'm buying right now. That's, again, with a friend of mine. He's very hands-on. He installs commercial kitchens into schools and restaurants and things. So he's like plumbing and electrics and all that stuff, which I'm crap at. So we're buying a property together, which we're going to refurb. So I can help with the finance and the legals aside, and he can do all the hands-on stuff. So that's a great partnership there, skills. And same with the franchise. In fact, I can do with the same guy I'm buying the second property with, my best friend. So he has time at weekends, so we can do some of this and all of these. So I'll have three income streams, which is the stocks and shares, which I don't class as an income stream. It's more my emergency fund. Yeah. The property definitely will be a huge income stream. and the business on the side. So if you wish, I'm diversifying the three asset classes, which can make me wealthy. Now, there's going to be some time element there. So I do work weekends. I work 7 days a week as a cabbie. I take 2 days off a year, Christmas Day and Boxing Day. So I might have to sacrifice those weekend cabbies works for the franchise. But I'll only do that if the money I get from the franchise is greater than the hours, the money I would have made had I been cabbying.
Yeah, that makes total sense. But, you know, at least you're going to give it a go. And if it works off you, then great. And it would be great to see that and to see someone.
Well, look, you're dead right there to give it a go. And most people don't give it a go because they're frightened of failing. Well, I forget the statistics now, but I think it's 4 to 5 businesses will go bust in the first 3 years of trading. So based upon those statistics, I will fail, almost definitely fail. It's a 4 to 5, 8 to 20, I'm going to fail here. Yep. So, but that's not an excuse. That's not a reason to not try, which is what people use as an excuse. You just have to go into business knowing that you're probably going to fail. So if you do fail, don't beat yourself up about it, because the odds were stacked against you anyway. But on the times that you do win, you win big. And the beauty of buying a franchise is it's a working model. You can look at the model that's working right now, and all you have to do is replicate what the business owner is doing right now, and you should have the success where you are. So it's a much safer model than setting a business from scratch, where you're taking a chance and saying, well, I've got a bit of an idea, I've got a feeling that this should work. In a franchise, you look at an already successful model, and all you're doing is just taking it from this place to that place, and it should replicate, all things being equal. So, well, yes, the odds are stacked against me, but by buying a franchise, I'm kind of making them more even Stevens in the middle.
I think so as well, because I've looked myself into possibly diversifying into franchises, you know, in probably the next 10 years or so, because it's another income stream. And I've looked at, I myself looked at the hospitality just because I thought, well, how much is it? How do you do it? And I think I looked at Subway, and I think it was like an initial investment. I could be wrong here. It was one of the franchises of about 25 grand to get started, 25 or 50 K to get started. And yeah, you get all the training provided, and then obviously they'll give you a location, and then you have to set you that you're the owner of that then. And then you get the yearly income from that. And obviously some of the early income goes to the corporate head corporate office and whatever. But it was just really interesting to find out that anyone can do it, you know, at franchise opportunities. And
McDonald's. Oh yeah, it was McDonald's model. McDonald's model was that it cost them nothing to open a new shop somewhere else. Imagine where you have a model and you can open up an endless amount of stores across the world, and it costs you absolutely nothing, which is how they become a franchise. They get the franchisee to pay for all the building costs, or the rental costs, or the installation of all the machines. The franchisee picks up all that. So my franchise model is there's essentially very little large capital outlay for it in terms of buying kits, equipment. And we need some storage space, but my best mate already, as I said, installs kitchen, so he's got some industrial units where we'll just use that. So again, it reduces the risk element to us. So it just suited us fine. We could both work weekends. He's got loads of trucks that carry big stuff around, so we didn't need to buy any extra vehicles. We didn't need to buy stores. So to us, it was a good idea. But who knows? Time will tell, and I'll record it and we'll see how it goes.
Definitely, and I'll look forward to personally seeing that myself. Cool. So yeah, I wanted to talk to you. I watched your video about 3 books not to buy, and I have read all 3. I've definitely read 2 of them. And one of them was Rich Dad, Poor Dad. And one of them was Think and Grow Rich. And the one that you said about Rich Dad, Poor Dad, I think would be controversial to a lot of people. But I think you could be right in terms of the story. Because you're claiming that obviously the story is completely made up, right? But a lot of people will say the story is made up.
In fact, in Richard and Robert Kiyosaki's later books, there's a disclaimer in there now that says that the people in this were fictional and made up to demonstrate some financial philosophy, which I had. He says that, and it's actually written in there, but he still goes around telling people, my rich dad told me this and my poor dad, da, da, da. And I keep shouting at the screen, no, Richard, you've already admitted they didn't exist. Right? Stop saying it. It's not working. It's not true. But he does it. I mean, I have a number of issues with Robert Kiyosaki. First of all, Yes, he made them up. And how he got found out was because some reporter thought, well, great idea, because it's a great backstory. You know, I've got this rich dad and poor dad. By the way, his poor dad was his actual dad, right? So, I mean, the guy brought Robert up when he had nothing and fed him
clothes. Just slating his own dad.
He was a pillar of the community. He was a lecturer in college and he retired on his full pension and everything. You know, but yeah, poor dad. Piece of work, Robert. But there's rich dad. So anyway, a reporter thought, well, it's a great story. Why don't we go and interview the rich dad? And we'll say, you know, do you remember Robert and that? Are you aware of the impact you had on his life? You know, and Robert says some things in the book. He gives some clues to what the business was and where it was. And so we thought it should be too hard to track the guy down. Anyway, they looked and had a good look for him, couldn't find him. And then they go back to Robert. Robert can't find this guy. And after being really persistent and chasing Robert down as to why, you know, where's this guy? He says, yeah, well, I made it up. You know, just it doesn't matter. It's just an allegorical tale. Which is fine, but if it said that right at the beginning, say, look, I've made these characters up because I've got an ebook and there's three characters in there, Mr. Gotnout, Mr. Ambridge, and Mr. Luxridge. A completely fabricated characters. I don't pretend they're real people, but Robert did that. So you think, well, hang on, why your whole premise is built on a lie, and it's only a small thing, but why won't you just tell the truth right from the very beginning? And then he said some stuff which I just disagree with, which your house is a liability because if you lose your job, you've got to pay a mortgage. Well, yeah, but if you're just renting and you lose your job, you lose the house anyway because you're going to pay your rent. I don't see the difference. But your house has a value. It's an asset. It has a value. It might cost you to repay the mortgage, but any balance sheet, the house will be in the asset column and the mortgage is in the liability column. It's the mortgage that sucks. Nobody likes paying a bloody mortgage. In fact, that's what we call it, the bloody mortgage. But it's the house is an asset, whichever way you look at it. So I've already got that wrong as well.
Yeah.
And so I mean, you watched his recent stuff. He's now going at some conspiracy theory where he talks about them. As they don't want you to reach you. They don't want you to know the stuff. I'm telling you this because they don't want you to. Well, he never explains who they are. There's another. That's another fabricated bunch of people.
Yeah, I do watch his channel. Just bits when he gets guests on when they talk about gold and things like that. But you know, I just watch bits and pieces. But it's kind of like because people like that have kind of lied in the past, I take some of the things with a pinch of salt.
Pinch of salt, yeah. And you know, and people say to me, you know, he's had a great impact, like Think and Grow Rich. I've got close friends, and it was one of the first books I read. And you think and Grow Rich, and Robert Kiyosaki, it's great when you hear it for the first time, when you hear that message that a positive attitude will help you. It's the first time you've heard it, you think, light bulb, great, what a fabulous book. But it's not that he wasn't the first to say that. It was just the first time you read it. Yep. And so to you, it's brand new knowledge, but there's nothing in Kiyosaki's book and Napoleon Hill's Think and Grow Rich. It's any original stuff. It's just stuff that's been said for years and years and years, hundreds of years before. That's how people become wealthy hundreds of years before these guys that did the same techniques. But if it's the first time you've heard it, to you, it's like, it's gold, you know, it's these guys are fantastic and they're heroes, but there's nothing original in anything. And by the way, I say nothing original.
Yeah,
I'm not here saying that I have all the answers. Well, I have a lot of answers, but it's the old Newton thing. Because if I seem to see further than other people, it's because I ride on the shoulders of giants. It's just because I'm learning from the people of the past. You go back to Babylonian times, and they tell you how to get wealthy. Just we seem to think it doesn't work now, but the same principles that worked back then work now, and I'm proof of the pudding. It does work.
Yeah, speaking of Babylonian times, that's one of the books that you did recommend to buy, which was my first book on wealth, actually, was The Richest Man in Babylon, which is a fantastic
great book.
Yeah, just the principle.
It's a great book in that it tells, we all like stories, you know, we are, our species grew up on stories, you know, cavemen were painting walls and things, and we there's something about stories that we love, and Jesus spoke in parables to get his message across, and as did other, you know, the Buddha and the people, we just love stories, and The Richest Man in Babylon tells a story of a chariot maker. And he applies the principles which a lot of other gurus say, you know, save 10% of your salary, make sure you invest for your long term. Basic principles, which when taken to heart and put into action, not just read and think, oh, that book's great, I've really enjoyed that book, I've really learned something there. And then do nothing. You've got to do things. You know, all the positive, going back to Napoleon, you know, all the positive thinking in the world won't mean anything unless you take positive action. It's like, you know, now the sort of the thing that people talk about now, a lot of people talk about now, is the law of attraction. I've seen some massive gurus. Tony Robbins does courses on the law of attraction, this sort of thing. And they're all predisposed on human laziness, and that we write these books in the hope that you don't have to bloody work for it, and all you've got to do is think about it and be positive and concentrate on the law of attraction, will then just manifest itself into physical reality and without doing any work whatsoever. And you can see why they're popular. You know why? I mean, if Napoleon Hill called his book, you know, Work and Grow Rich, it wouldn't have sold so many. But Think and Grow Rich, well, I can think, I can become rich. No, you've got to put some action in as well. That's the difference.
Yeah, that's true. I remember you said that in your video, and it made me giggle. It's just because you're right. It's kind of one of those. I actually read something similar in Robert Kiyosaki's book. It was like what they don't teach you in school, and that was like a controversial thing to say on a book, you know. Mm. And if he rewrote anything like boring, like you said, he sells, he wouldn't be like the number one bestseller or whatever. So it's all these like magic words that get people to buy them.
I mean, the real genius in that relationship, by the way, is his wife. She's a switched on cookie. She's the one that buys all the properties and watch her stuff. She's quite clever.
Yeah, what's Kim? Kim Kiyosaki, is it? Yeah.
Exactly. I forget that again. But yeah, she is very good. I think she was the brains behind the whole thing. And I don't know this for sure, but I would imagine that he's changed tack very much and gone to this conspiracy thing. Yeah, what they don't want you to know, what they don't teach you in school, and they don't want you to know this. I wouldn't surprise me if she was the brains behind that little shift as well, because she's a smart cookie.
Yeah, you never know. You never know with these things. So what do you think of, what is your thoughts on people that like want to get rich quick then, and you know, all these like pyramid schemes, have you heard of all these, and what do you think of the people that are trying to promote them, and do you think there should be like tougher laws?
I can't think bad of them because I did it. I've done all sorts of think the stupid things I've done. I got into multi-level marketing, selling skinny powder. You know, you take this powder and make you skinny. And then you go around the country. I went to the country and stood on some big stages because I believed it, and half wanted to believe it. I suspect that's what it is. I think I wanted to believe it. But when you go to the audience and you get the same, I go to Manchester, I go to a meeting, and then I go to London and go to a meeting, and the same fat people are standing up in the audience saying, "Yes, I lost 30 pounds on this stuff." Wait a minute, you were in Manchester. And you've lost no weight since the last time I saw you, fat knacker. Yes, it doesn't. But then you think, oh God, I borrowed money to get in that scheme, you know, borrowed money off my dad. And bless me, he died this year. Dad.
Sorry to hear that.
Yeah, I borrowed money off him, and you think, oh, just because you're so desperate to get it to work, and you want to work, and you only want the best for your family, let's be honest, and best for yourself as well. And if somebody can say, look, I'm making £7,000 a month, which is a huge sum of money, but it's a nice sum of money now, but back in, I don't know, 20 years ago, it was a massive, incredible sum of money for somebody to make. And just copy me, and you can do it, and there's really no work, and da da da. And you want to believe it, so you do believe it. And it's a great shame. So all I can say to those people is save your money, invest your money. If you look at the thousands of pounds it takes you to get to a decent level on some of these multi-level markets, marketing scams, dare I call them that, then you could just save that money and just stick it into a Vanguard tracker and make you more money. More likely to make more money than the next get rich quick scheme, which God knows I've invested enough time in myself.
Yeah, I was close myself once to invest in 6K into this, like, it's called a Kangen water machine or some bullshit. And it's like supposed to be like this miracle water where you put the filter system in your sink or something, and it comes out with this water that's supposed to be really good for your insides, and you know, I got convinced.
I know, it's funny when you're laughing now and you see it, you think, no, it's just freaking water, mate.
I know, it tastes just like water.
Yeah, it's funny that. Yeah. No, Coca-Cola, didn't they? Coca-Cola sold their own water. They were just taking it from the taps in Kent, and they bottled it, and then they lost a lot of capital. If you were not capital, well, money-wise, because they invested a lot in it, well, a lot of goodwill when Coca Cola the same was just tap water and think, Jesus.
I bet their share price went
down. We're laughing about it now. And you think, why did I believe that?
Yeah, but luckily, just the gut, I nearly, and then they were convincing me, like, this is how bad they are. They were convincing me to, like, get credit cards out. So I went to try and get the first credit card, and I could get, like, only 3K on it. And then they were like, we'll get another one out with another 3K. So they're trying to get me to get two credit cards out. And I haven't, at this point before, I hadn't had, this was in 2017, mid-2017. And I had never had a credit card in my life. And there was me applying for credit cards. And then like before I got the first one, and I was like, I don't know, something like my gut was like, what are you doing? So I backed out, blocked everyone to do with this MLM thing. I did pay £90 for the training, which was, again, just an introductory bullshit fee. But I cut the credit card up straight away as soon as it arrived in the post. I think I avoided something disastrous there. And
I'll tell you something else I did as well, which is, which I kind of beat myself up about, is there was a, I met a guy, I was on holiday one time. A solicitor friend of mine had one of these £500,000 yachts, and he wasn't on it for the weekend. He says, Perry, do you want to use this yacht? It's free of charge, it's more to help yourself, mate. I said, oh, great. So I took the wife and family on this yacht in Portugal. Met a guy there, and he owned a golf company. He got me very interested in the golf business, because I love playing golf. Mm. I did love playing golf. I can't afford it at the time anymore. But and he said, well, fancy coming to business? So, because I was more of, I'm a bit of a sales guy. So I went to his office in Scotland. So I visited Scotland. So they had an office with three people working in Scotland. So I spent a couple of days there, and phones were ringing and taking the golf holiday business. Mm. And I went to, I saw this guy on his yacht, his sailing yacht. And I went to his house in Spain as well, a villa in Spain. So I did all the research I did and say, yeah, okay, and I'll put £40,000 into it to this business. And we were also, and then we got the Prince's Trust, the first Prince's Trust Corporate Golf Challenge, which we ran. So I put the money in, looked at a great idea, done all my research, and then 2 months later, I went to insolvency.
Oh,
what?
No.
What happened there? You know, just disappeared. Yeah. You know, I never see the guy again. Sold the yacht, disappeared off the face of the earth. So I mean, so you can do all the due diligence, and sometimes you just get a kick in the stones, you know.
Yeah, at least you did your part, though. You know, you covered yourself. Well, as you said, you did all the due diligence that you possibly thought you could have. So at least you didn't just run into it. You know, but that's just a shame that happened. But 40K, imagine if that was in your stocks and shares ISA right now.
Oh, God, can you imagine? What I did, I remortgaged the house. So it wasn't even all mine. It was half of it was the wife. So,
oh, Jesus.
She doesn't let me forget that, by the way.
Yeah, no, I bet not. But so what does your wife think of and your friends and family think of your goal and what, you know, you want your yacht? In the next, would it be 7 years' time? Is that when you'll plan to have that yacht?
Yeah, it'll be, well, I'm 59 now, so I'll get to 67, so 8 years' time.
Yeah.
I don't talk much about it. I've always been a little different. So I've always perhaps considered myself the idiot of the family. So what's Crazy Perry doing next sort of thing? So now it's working. I'm not saying anything. Although I have said to my mother, I'm going to this yacht. You're getting a yacht. What are you talking about? You're getting a yacht? I said, well, I'm going to get a yacht. What? You're crazy? But you can't afford a yacht. I said, well, I can't now, but I've got a plan, and the plan's working, and I'm going to get a yacht. And what are you going to do with the yacht? Well, I'm going to sail it. You can't sail. Just all these stuff. You think, well, I wish I hadn't said anything. But then I'll say something like, my sister will say, well, you buying a house? Oh, yeah, I've got one. I did it complete. Oh, yeah, complete. I want the second one now. You're on your second one. Oh, well, that's great, isn't it? So you get, from different sides of the family, you get some positivity and others. And you know what it is? It's not because my mother or your parents in general want to see you do badly, or they just don't want you to get hurt. They don't want you to lose money. Yeah. And so they just say, just sit back, just do what normal people do, and just be happy with your lot. And then everybody will be safe and happy. And, you know, it's a little comfort blanket around you. So it's not done out of malice. It's just because they don't want to see you fail. Well, I don't care if I fail. Never care if I fail.
Yes.
In fact, one of the reasons I'm documenting all my stuff in here is because it gives me the discipline to keep on going. Because so many times in the past, I've got halfway to something that I say, oh, I'm bored with this. I've had pubs, I've run pubs where we've built them up from £3,000 a week to £10,000 a day takings. And I walked away from a successful business just because I got bored. Done it and then just want to do something else. And so I'm hoping that if I record what I'm doing to the world, as a discipline of myself to keep on going, And this is working as well. It genuinely is working. So, and the other thing is, I've only got bloody 9 years to go till I retire at 67. And if it doesn't work, I've got nothing. Yeah. So this is last drink saloon for me.
Yeah.
And it is working. And it's not glamorous, by the way. You know, I'm a cabbie. I'm not a solicitor. I've got no skills. I've got no qualifications. So it's not glamorous. I work 60, 75 hours a week. I take 2 days off a year. It's the sort of thing that any and every man can do. You know, it's no skills. If I can do it, you can do it. It is working. I'm so happy. I wake up in the morning buzzing sometimes instead of being depressed, which I have been, not clinically depressed, but you know, you get down when you try lots of times and you fail lots of times. It's difficult to get down. And the older you get, it's, you know, when you say, you know, the measure of man is not how many times you get knocked down, it's how many times you get back up. But as you get older, Shane, it gets harder to get back up. Mm-hmm. It genuinely does. And so I wake up in the morning buzzing now because what I'm doing is working. It's I'm recorded it, so and people can't say it's working. They can't say it doesn't work because it is working. And it's not like I'm selling something here. I'm not selling courses or anything. It's everything's on there free of charge. You just go make some bloody money, guys.
Yeah, I think you wake. It's kind of like myself. Like I think you wake up every morning buzzing because you've got a set goal. You know what you want to do. You know the time frame, and because you know all this stuff, you're happy to kind of be alive and do it and show your progress. And because you know where you are. Like there's people that wake up miserable and depressed because they don't know what they want to do in life. They don't know where they're going. They're spending all their money on shit they don't need. They think it will make them happy, but it won't. But you're different. You've kind of, you know, woke up one morning and go, right, well, I want this. Okay, how am I going to get that? And obviously you've done what everyone should do, done your goal at the top. So obviously you're yachting to be financially independent. So you've broken that down and worked backwards, haven't you?
It's exactly right. And isn't that what all the leadership books have told you in the past? All the leadership books I've read that say you can need a goal, then you need a plan, you need a goal. And I went, don't need that. Yep. We'll just wing it, you know, here we go, guys. Yeah. Strap yourselves in, brace yourselves, we're all going for it. And it never worked. It never did work. And when I got to 55, when I got a couple of pensions that turned up, and I realized that in my entire life, I'd saved up £3,500, for God's sake. That was a kick in the stones. And at 57, it took me 2 years. Well, after I'd spent the bloody money, that £3,500 I spent, I forgot what I spent it on. I don't know what it was. But that disappeared. No, and at 57, I had 10 years left now to do something. But all that stuff that I'd read and I'd completely ignored was what transformed my life. I needed a goal. First of all, you need a goal. So it's something that gets you up in the morning. It's not a number, although you can put a number on it. My goal, I sat one time and I said, right, what would I want to make, not so much make me happy, that I would know that I have made it. Because when you say, well, I want to be wealthy, well, what's wealthy if you've got nothing, not had a pot of piss in all your life, and somebody gives you £10,000, you'll feel wealthy. It's so, you know, if a billionaire takes his billion off and give him £1 million, he won't feel wealthy anymore because he's not a billionaire. So it's not a number, it's a feeling. So I thought, what would I have to feel, what would I have in order to make me feel wealthy? And for somebody who's been wanting to be wealthy for such a long time, it took me a while to work it out. And I came to the conclusion that if I was on a yacht, a luxury yacht, a sailboat, sailing around the Med, and I had hundreds of thousands of pounds in the bank, yeah, I'd feel wealthy. That's what I'd feel. So yeah. I said, okay. And so I went, well, how much does the yacht cost? Well, you don't want to buy them brand new because just like cars, they devalue massively. So you can get a beautiful 50-foot Beneteau, for instance, for between 80 and 100 grand. So I said, right, 800 grand. What about how much you're going to need in the bank? And it worked out by the time I got that, I was 67, that if I had 200 grand in the bank, that would be enough to live off it. Now, you live pretty frugally on a yacht because there's not a lot of space for clothes and furniture and stuff, so and food. So you live pretty much day to day in jeans, not jeans, shorts and a T-shirt. So it's a great life to live. So you don't need an awful lot of money. So I reckon, okay, 100 for the yacht, 200 grand in the bank, 300 grand, right? When we're going to do it? Well, I had a self-imposed date because I was retiring 10 years' time. So it was 67 in 10 years. So, all right, 300 grand. So there's your goal. So the yacht gets me up in the morning. The yacht gets me up at 5:30 every morning, 7 days a week, because I know if I don't get up, it reduces the chance of me getting that yacht. So there's my goal. That's what gets me up buzzing in the morning. Now I need a plan. So what sort of plan are we going to have? Well, I was working behind a bar, started at 5:00 in the evening till 12:30, did that 5 nights a week, So that was my full-time job. So I needed to, so they gave me the day off to do something else. And I looked at a few things that I could, that were flexible enough to allow me to work during the day and the night time. And I decided I'd be a driver, you know, deliver stuff and whatever during the daytime. Mm-hmm. So anyway, I decided to be a cabbie. So I did the knowledge test, such as it is, and got myself the police, the DBS checks, and then paid my license fee and all that stuff. So for a while, I was working from 7 o'clock in the morning to 4 o'clock as a cabbie. And then I would go to the bar at 5 and work till half midnight. And I did that for about 3 months, which is quite unsustainable. Unsustainable, whichever word it is.
One of the two.
And so I gave up the bar job because the hourly rate as a cabbie was more. So then but I still work about 2 full-time jobs. I'm working 60 hours a week now, a little over 60, just because of COVID. It's so quiet out there. It's really sometimes not worth going in. Mm. But when COVID's over, as it will be, I work 75 hours a week as a cabbie. So there I have a goal, which was my 300,000. And it's not just a number, it was a yacht. And it was me lying on the yacht with the wife, sailing the Mediterranean as pirates, full of rum and victuals.
Love it.
And so that's my goal. And then I had a plan to make it work. And that's what so many people miss. And that's how they don't achieve anything. They go through life as I was, just thinking, you know, let's just see what life throws up at you. You know, who can tell? You can't predict the future. Well, you can pretty much predict the future, because what you do today will make the future, will create the future. And I get the stage now where I obsess about numbers, where I know if I start work at 6 o'clock in the morning, I know what I've got to have made by 8 o'clock, whether I'm going to hit my target of the day. So I've got a daily target. I've got the first 2 hours target. And obviously that all adds up to weekly targets. And the monthly target is £900, gets rammed in my savings account, along with the property I bought now. So what I did was, let's go by it. So yeah, that was my plan. So my plan was £900 savings. And I did that for 2 years. Somebody commented on one of Mike Winnett's, when he put my interview of his interview of me on his site, that they don't believe me because I said I'd put regular updates on there of my financial, where we go every month. And I said, look, well, it's a bit boring and it is boring, it's a grind. I said, if I just put a video on in January and said, well, I've made £900 this month, and the next month I said, well, I've got £1,800 now, and the next month, like I said, I said, it'd be pretty boring. So I've put my own philosophy into videos, but the updates I do when I hit a milestone. And it took me 2 years of working 75 hours a week, taking 2 days off a year, Christmas Day and Boxing Day. It's a grind, but after 2 years, I'd saved up £20,000 thereabouts. And I bought my first property in September this year. That brings in £400 with a net rent after the mortgage is off. So now I'm saving £900 plus the £1,300. My friend and I are refurbing a property using his money for that, which will refinance, get his money out, and we'll have a second property there, and that'll be income. In July, it'll take another year till July next year to save up enough money for a third property. And then that'll be £400. So that's 1,300 plus 400. That's 1,700. Plus I get my Navy pension at 12 years in the forces, which is only £300. So in July next year, I'll be saving £2,000 a month. And thereafter, I'll be buying a property every 10 months. And then as the income increases, the time span to buy properties narrows, and plus I'm doing the franchise, so that'll be more income coming in. So I reckon over that time, I'll have bought it between now and I'm 67, I'll have bought 20 properties. And those numbers look like, I don't think, I set my goal of that £300,000 based upon my perspective of, at the time, working minimum wage behind a bar. Now I'm where I am now, where I'm 6 months away from financial independence, that my perspective changed. And I think that goal would probably won't be 300,000. I think it'd be closer to 800,000. And if by the time the mortgages are up, when I get to 80, because that's the limit on the mortgages, mm-hmm. I think the rents will have come in at about 1.3 million
Insane.
On top of the 800,000 in equity.
And you know, that's
good,
that's amazing.
And if anybody can do it, and I'm nothing special, Shane. You know, yep. You're talking to me, I'm just a cabbie from Gateshead, you know, I'm not blinking Mike Ashley or anything like that. I'm just doing normal stuff. I'm working hard. I'm not spending my money. I'm investing, saving as much as I can. I'm investing it so my money's working as hard as I am. I'm taking my £20,000. I'm buying a property. It's paying another £400 in. Hopefully it grows in value as well. And I take that money in, after another year, I buy another property. And that's how the rich become rich. It's by they buy assets that they kick out money, and you shouldn't blame the rich either. You know, it's not their fault once because they keep getting richer. It's difficult to see the numbers of what you're at a smaller scale as I am right now. But if you look at somebody who's a billionaire, and if a billionaire gets 10% on his money, he's making 100 million on his money. So now he's a billionaire. He probably doesn't need 100 million because he's probably got everything he wants anyway. So he's just got 100 million comes into the bank. What does he do with it? Well, he doesn't leave the bank because it's a crap interest rate. It's losing. It's devaluing because of inflation. He'll invest it again. So now he's getting a billion plus 100 million. He's investing that in the same place. And that's kicking out 110 million next year. And he can't help but get wealthier. It's just maths. It's not because he's evil. It's not because he's greedy. He can't help with the money. When you get the figures that big, they just keep multiplying. There's nothing you can do. And you can give it away. You can do like Bill Gates. Bill Gates, you know, he's got 90 billion in his account and he's curing cholera across the world. And you can do that now. And that's what you can do. But it's not their fault they're wealthy. They worked hard. It's their fault they became wealthy because they worked very hard for it. But they keep getting richer and richer and richer. And that's not their fault. That's just maths.
Yeah, work hard until you don't have to work hard, I think. That's kind of, you know, one of those.
You're trading your time now. Yep. I'm doing two full-time jobs now, the equivalent to two full-time jobs, so that I can have a great life in 9 years' time.
Yeah.
It's a trade-off.
I love it. And you know what? Like, you just mentioned Bill Gates there. I've read something today that Bill Gates lives off the interest of that interest of that interest. You know, because he's that rich, he's living off
the original money he earned was gone long time. I don't know where that is now, but he's just living on interest.
On the interest.
He got out.
Yeah, but you know what? No matter what he was to do now, he just, like, I think that old thing when I was younger, someone said to me, I thought probably about 10, like, have you heard of Bill Gates? Like, no. And when I found out who he was like, okay, if Bill Gates was to drop a suitcase of £1 million, and by the time he picked it up, he would have, like, tripled it or something stupid.
I think the calculation was that how much wedge would there have to be on the pavement for to waste his time bending down to pick it up? It was a crazy amount of money.
Oh my god, I'd love to know what he actually earns a minute in something like broken down.
And I think he only owns about 5% of Microsoft now. He just lives off his money now, doesn't he?
Yeah,
have no flat to do with the business anymore.
But you know, instead of like this is what like I see on Facebook all the time, and I try to not go on Facebook because of this reason. I see people like digging into the rich, and Jeff Bezos comes out all the time. You know, and I did a post the other day, and I'm not thinking for all those people that are buying Black Friday on Amazon, you're contributing to his wealth. So stop moaning, stop moaning about him. Like you're making him richer by buying on Amazon, you know. These guys have worked hard. They've been smart. They've invested their money. They don't buy stupid clothes and expensive cars. They probably do that now if they want to, but they didn't.
Yeah.
They were like in their early 20s. I mean, going back to something you said, which I've been telling people actually, and they don't believe me until I show them your video. And it's you can become a millionaire if you work at McDonald's. Do you want to talk about that one?
Yeah, it's something massive. I've got an app on my iPhone. It's a compound interest calculator, and compound interest is phenomenal. It's how you get interest on your interest. You've touched on it before. So if you're working at McDonald's and all you do is you save or invest in something like a Vanguard, a cheap index tracker, something like Vanguard, and you take 2 hours of your weekly wage from age 18 to age 67 as it is now, and you stay at McDonald's all your life, then you would have £1 million when you retire. It's just maths. You can get on any compound interest calculator. Now there's some added bits in there. Is that if he's 18, he'll be on a minimum wage. So start on minimum wage to do the calculation. But as he grows up, he won't be on minimum wage. And as he grows up, he will get, you'd hope, promotions, and so his wage will increase as well. So when you do that calculation on a compound interest calculator, make sure you add something in there for inflation. It gets a rise every year. I think I added 3% for that.
Yeah.
But it's just maths. And there's no getting away from it. You can't deny it because it's just maths. Maths don't lie. It doesn't care about your feelings or your prejudices. If you put a number in and you increase it by so much a year, then you put an index tracker. Now, what sort of interest rate do you get on an index tracker? Well, it depends upon the index you're investing in. But let's say it's the FTSE 100. The FTSE 100 has grown on average since its inception in 18, whenever it was, by about 11% a year. Now let's assume that we work on an inflation rate of 3%, so you're getting a real time return of 8%. So if you're doing that, put your money in over the time at 8%, over a massive amount of time, so he's 18 till he's 67, what's that, 48 years, 49 years, the compounding effect of compounding is massive. And whilst in the early days he's making next to nothing because he's only putting 2 hours of his, he's sat at the wage in there, by the time he gets to 67, he's probably adding £100,000 a year just at a compound interest. Mm-hmm. But play with the numbers yourself. I play with them all the time on my phone. Just ooh, look at that. Well, if I add 3% here, and I can get a better return here, which is why I moved. I originally went. I've got an index tracker. I put £100 a month into it. It was going to my no, it wasn't. My original plan was to get a pension, because that's what normal people do. You get a pension, don't you? And the good things about a pension is you get a 20%. Return of your tax on it, so you get 20% interest day one. But you can't set a pension up by yourself, or you probably can now using a Thank God SIP.
Yeah.
But in the day you couldn't, so I had to go to a pension advisor who charged me £900 to set it up. Well, I say a pension advisor, I can now call them licensed bandits. £900 to open up this pension in an underperforming fund. So I think I was in there for about 6, 7, 9 months, and I pulled the money out. Because it just wasn't making enough. And then I opened my Vanguard index tracker, and I put money in there. I think it's grown in the last 2 years. I think it's 28% up, even with the COVID fall. It's 28% up. It's tiny charges, 0.2%. It's a fantastic thing. But I drip £100 a month in there, because I don't have the time that the 18-year-old at McDonald's has. I don't have that 40-odd years anymore. I've got 10 years. And I really need a better interest rate, even though it's growing at about 11% a year. I need something more, which is why I moved into property, because in property I can get a 25% cash on cash return from property. Now, what I mean by that, well, if it cost me £20,000 to buy a property, that's with the deposit, the stamp duty, the legals, the broker fees, a little bit of a refurb, you know, painting, that sort of thing, comes to about £20,000. But if I'm getting a net £400 a month, that's 4,800. So let's call it £5,000. I'm putting 20 grand in, I'm getting nearly £5,000 out. I'm getting nearly 25% return on my cash each year.
Yeah.
And that's why I love property. So that's why I moved from doing the index tracker, although I have that as my emergency fund. There's probably, I think, £3,500 in there now. Say I only add to it £100 a month. But the best return that I get in the short term I have is from property. And you invest in property, don't you?
I will be, yes. I'm currently saving up with my business partner to go into property and developments. But I have my investments in my index trackers and my individual stocks at the moment. So I've been, in fact, I put some in yesterday in the life strategy one on Vanguard. Oh, yeah. So I've got, I've invested in 5. I think it's a Life Strategy, an ESG fund, the FTSE 100, the FTSE 250, and the S&P 500. And every month I'm going to put 10% of my wage into each one and then keep rolling over that. I think that's my plan anyway, and just watch it grow. I'm already getting
10% split between them, or 10% each of them?
Nah, so like this month I'll put 10% in Life
Strategy. You say you're going to put 10% into them. Do you mean you're going to take 10% of your salary and split it amongst them, or you're going to put 10% in this one?
10% into, so 10% of this month's wage into just
good
the one
man.
Fund, and then next month.
How old are you, Shane?
28.
You're 28, good man.
Yeah.
Pretty wise for your age.
Yeah.
Wish you had done that.
It's just literally this year since COVID, I've just suddenly woke. I was in New Zealand, stranded in New Zealand, because I've been traveling for a while, but COVID came. You know, I had a job in New Zealand, and I thought I'm coming home this year, and I'm like, well, I've got a little bit of savings. If COVID ever happens again, what financial security have I got? You know, luckily that I was in a job in New Zealand, but like, what financial security have I got when I get home? So I thought, well, how do I get rich? And I looked at all these ways, and I thought, well, get rich quick doesn't work. That's a load of bollocks. So I thought, well, then I looked at property, and it's like, and then from property, you know, people talk about stock shares, and I was reading wealth books, watching wealthy people, their interviews, what their views to what asset classes they've invested in. So like, since getting home, I've invested in stocks and shares, I've invested in property, but not in terms of buying my own. I'm investing in property projects to see a return. I've bought gold as a to act as a hedge. That's securely away, you know. So I'm just making all these financial smart decisions now. Literally, since April this year, I read my first wealth book in April this year. Before that, I couldn't even tell you what stocks and shares ISA is. So literally this year, I've started my wealth journey, and I hate that word, but you know what I mean. So yeah, that's my plan.
It's important you learn as you point. You keep learning. I don't watch television. I know a lot of people say that. I don't watch television. I generally don't. I watch YouTube a lot, so I'm subscribed to a lot of these wealth creation channels, and I love watching them. So I'll probably spend 2 hours a night. Tonight's an exception because I'm talking to you, but normally about 2 hours a night I'll watch these things. A, to learn, and B, because it gives me inspiration to do my own videos. You know, you can learn a lot from other people who are already ahead of you in the journey, if you wish. So as you say, you continue to learn constantly. And if you don't learn, you're going backwards. You'll go backwards because absolutely, the world is moving forward. And if you don't move forward at the speed of the world is, then you're getting left behind, which sadly is what happens to a lot of old people, is they stop learning.
Absolutely.
My parents are the same, you know. Oh, I don't need internet. I said, I'll put internet in your house so you can, you know, go ask a question. I said, just Google it. Oh, yeah, I'm going, well, what's Google? Right. Okay. I'll put internet in your house. I'll put a computer in, and you can do all that stuff. The Frank Sinatra movies, it's all online. You can watch anything for free. Mm-hmm. Don't need a television. Everything's on there. But, you know, I don't need to do that anymore. So they don't have phones, and they don't have to. And what happens is they become irrelevant because the world moves past them. And they're back there, and they have no relevance to the world, and which is why I guess when a lot of young people ignore old people because they're so in the past, if you wish, the world's moved on, and so they can't talk about what's happening now. So it's important. The older I get, of course, and the closer I get to my parents' age, is that I continue to learn constantly. So I watch and read, or I've got two books in my cabinet. One is Warren Buffett's three favorite books.
Oh yeah.
The Intelligent Investor is one of them, but there's a couple of other ones in there which are fit. And the other one is a franchise book, How to Pick a Good Franchise.
Oh, brilliant.
So in my downtime when I'm watching, if I'm not on my phone watching stuff, then I'm reading and writing stuff in the margin, question marks, and check this out. And somebody will say something on YouTube, and then I'll make a note on my phone and say, right, do a video on this because this is a good subject. But it's researching and learning constantly and never stop learning.
Yeah, love that. And the fact that, you know, your age as well, like I told my dad about you, and I showed him the video of You Might Win It, and he was like, well, that's amazing that like someone at your age is doing it now. You know, it's not too late. Not too late
because
at all.
It was stupid. That's why. It was stupid. Yeah. Don't take any praise for doing it now. Think of the 40, 50 years beforehand when I was a complete knobhead and didn't do any of it. And that's...
Yeah. Well, you know what? Doing it now. And I think, to be honest, I think you're going to do well. And I'd like to definitely get you on in probably a year's time or 2 years' time.
We'll do a catch-up.
Yeah, definitely.
We'll talk about the franchise. So hopefully it's making money.
Yeah, 100%. And hopefully when this COVID's over, we'll have to actually meet up in person too. It'd be great.
Definitely.
But I've got three questions before we wrap it up. And these are just random ones that I'm going to be throwing out to all my guests. So question one, what's your favorite movie?
Oh, you could have given me some warning. Go on.
Yeah. What's your favorite movie?
Matrix.
Matrix. Love it. Okay, cool.
Didn't have to think about it. It was a groundbreaking movie. It's been not ripped off, but hats tipped to it in things like a Shrek and thing, and the core bits of the Matrix in it as a nod towards it. It's a fantastic movie, and measure all these new movies and CGI from Matrix. Was it as good as the stuff in the Matrix? Because all that CGI stuff in the Matrix was phenomenal, and nothing had been done on that scale before. And then the story's great as well. So definitely Matrix.
100%. Just a quick one on the Matrix. Matrix 4 is coming out. Did you know that?
No, I didn't.
And Keanu Reeves, he's been filming it in San Francisco with the one who played Trinity.
Right.
Google it afterwards. Yeah, it's.
I will do. Yeah, I didn't know about. Cheers, mate.
By one of the Wachowski brothers.
All right, because the two of them made it.
I don't know, but one of them's doing it. So it's official. They've been filming it for the past year.
Wow.
Yeah.
I look forward to that then.
Yeah. All right. Cool. So, second question is favorite destination.
New York.
New York.
I've been in New York three times. I've been with New York to New York first with a friend of mine who took me. He used to work for American Express. So I went as a guest of American Express. The second time I went with my father. Bless him, we lost him in July. And that was for his 65th. And I took my wife about 3 years ago. And it's one of those places. Have you ever been, Shane?
Once, yes. Loved it.
After about 4 days, I think, yeah, I've pretty much seen everything I want to see here. But the day after I left, I missed it straight away. And it's not disappointing. It's one of those, when somebody bigs a place home, you think, well, I'll take a look at it. And you go and think, well, it wasn't all that. I've never heard anybody say, unless you're going to disappoint me, anybody say that, yeah, New York, no, man, it's like walking around a movie set. It's a magical place,
you know what?
It's a really nice place to be.
Took the words out of my mouth. I say it to everyone. You want to walk around a movie set, go to New York.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. It's brilliant. Absolutely lovely place. Magical.
Yeah, fantastic. I need to get myself back there soon. But anyway, last and final question. Name something. This will be an easy one for you. Name something that grinds your gears. With one of your some people, what is it? You do that series where it says things stupid people say.
Oh, right. Yeah. Yeah. there's so much.
Stitches. That was so
yeah, when to see here's the one. It's hard to be wealthy. It's hard to be wealthy. It's not hard to be wealthy. You know, have you seen that queue of immigrants at Cali? They're not coming here for a challenge, you know. You know, they don't look. We're sick of living in Syria. It's dead easy in Syria. We'll go to England because we're like a challenge because it's hard to get wealthy there.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
It's easy to get wealthy here. If you're in Syria or in Afghanistan, then you've got an excuse to say, yes, it's hard to get wealthy.
Yep.
But here, it's easy to get wealthy. All you got to do is a goal, a plan, and work your stones off to obsess about the plan, and you become wealthy.
Fantastic. What a way to end the show, indeed. Fantastic. All right, cool. Well, we'll just wrap it up then. If you could just tell people how to get in touch with you then, like your channels, your outlets, and if people...
Yeah, thank you very much. Well, everything's called stupid is the norm, because when it comes to finances, most people are stupid, including myself, until I change my ways. All of my stuff's on YouTube. So it's stupid is the norm. Type it into YouTube, it'll come up. Or if you want to visit the website, we've got some nice free ebooks which I've written, and some spreadsheets which is all free of charge. We don't sell anything from the website, and that's stupidisthenorm.co.uk.
Perfect. And you've got Instagram as well, haven't you? Twitter,
Instagram, Facebook page. It's all under stupid is the norm. Yeah, it's great. We're not extremely popular because our message is hard. You know, when people watch us and we say, well, you've got to work very hard. You got to work 75 hours a week. You don't have to work 75 hours a week. It's just because I am, because I left it too late. If you're younger than me, a lot younger than me, you don't have to work 75 hours a week. But it's been really great. I do appreciate your time.
All right. So that's been the All Right Talk Show. Thanks everyone for joining, and thank you more importantly to Perry, my guest. And we'll speak soon. Ciao.